Dun, 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 dun. All right, here we go. This is it, the completed latch assembly, made all out of walnut. Yep, got the little wheel on it. Nee, nee, nee. Oh yeah, look at that. Turned out beautiful, a little personalized, slightly. Brass inserts for the bolt holes that are going to hold it down. Little pin stop there. Yep. All goozy and steel pin, brass bearing action. It's quiet as a mouse and functional. It works. There you go. 20 days it took. 20 days to finish this. Yeah, it was the most complicated construction build that ever done. So many hours. I've nearly 200 hours in 20 days. There were some 14, 15 hour days, many of them strung in a row. So yeah, hence the burnout and everything that I had in the first week. After, you know, week one, I sort of got in the pace of things, and yeah. So, since mission log number 7, I did all the completion steps for the latch, obviously. I finished putting the stop block and glued that in place, used a recessed screw on the bottom to hold that in. And after getting it all assembled, I realized that that stop block isn't actually being used because the far end of the base, this part of the rotator actually stops naturally. It doesn't actually ever touch that. I guess it was, I don't know, a worst case scenario thing to put it there, but it doesn't actually really touch that stop. So, and obviously I merged the rotator assembly. The drawings called for a 45 degree bevel to be put on the bottom part of the rotator head. But actually, in practice, actually, when I got it together, that angle was not steep enough because the latch link is not 45 degrees. So there was a lot of tweaking in the end. Yeah, the geometry for the latch link arm was wrong. I mean, when I originally, I think I talked about it in number 7, when I was going from CAD files that I got, that I was using the geometry from the CAD files rather than just doing straight math for the latch link, which was a mistake. I should have just taken the math from the print. But I think what happened is there was a rounding up because it was supposed to be 68 degrees, but the CAD files didn't turn out to be like a fraction of 68 degrees. It was it was off by like 1.2 degrees, 1.3 degrees or something like that in the actual CAD files. So there was an issue either with the scaling of the files or the rendering of those angles. Something was off. But in the end, I ended up having to make lots of adjustments to those final angles. Even though I went and made those squaring blocks to do all the milling and everything, it was all wrong because there was an error somewhere in the geometry. And I still don't know whether it was that the actual numbers on the paperwork were wrong or if it was actually the CAD files that were wrong. They definitely were not one and the same. So in the end, I ended up just kind of just eyeballing the geometry of the completed assembly, looking at the latch link, and okay, it's got to be changed this way. And then I had to kind of change the holes a little bit. I had to enlarge the holes and file them out and everything. And it wasn't ideal, but yeah, in the end, there was just an error in there that I just didn't have time to, well, it did. Does it really matter whether the error was the numbers or the CAD files? There was an inconsistency there, so whatever. I had to just end up hand fitting the pieces like it was a handmade clock, you know. You just hand fit them together, and you know, the end result is, you know, goozy perfection. After I merged the rotator assembly, I started to hand carve the puller because I had put this together, glued it in two pieces. But I had to create this recess for the wheel. And there's really only one way to do that by hand. And that was using clock making methods. And I used a one of my fine pull saws to create the edges of the wheel well, you know, and I marked it down to a depth on the wood that I cut it down to, and using squaring blocks and such to guide the saw, very carefully put those two edges exactly where they needed to be, down to a given depth. And then took another pull saw and did this cross sawing method. Now, I showed this before when I made a slot in a dowel for the Disky T-shirt project. But yeah, this cross sawing, it's a way of like cutting down rapidly, getting chunks out, just sawing one way and then sawing the other way and getting the chunks out of the recess. And after I'd gotten it down a little bit, I just went to hand chiseling because the grain was going, you know, with the bottom of the recess. So it was very easy for me to get in there with a very sharp chisel and just hand chisel that out. I was very careful to tape in a backstop for all this to make sure that I didn't gouge up the back part of the puller, which is hanging over there. It's very important to protect the work. After I had gotten a chisel down and filed a little bit, got the bottom all nice and smooth, checked it with the wheel and put the wheel in and the pin to test the fit, and it was just right. And then I had to flip it over, and there were these two 45 degree bevels on the underside of the puller that it called for in the drawings. So I went and just hand did those using a 45 degree guide with the chisel. You know, this is where it's getting to be, you know, ancient techniques. And the final step for the puller was to drill the hole for the latch arm pin. And that I scrawled the crosshairs using the compass method, taking the measurement from the caliper with the compass to cross the little X on the top. And all of the pins in my assembly, they all are interference fit. So all the pins in the whole assembly could be removed. I could do test fitting and then push them out. But the one pin that is a one-way only is the one that is in the puller because there's no bottom to that. And so that pin I shaped in a certain way with a certain taper that when I was ready for the final assembly, I would push that pin in with a final snap, and it was flush and level. And when I did that final snap in for the final assembly, that pin was never coming out. and it was done. The last thing I had to do after I had gotten all the parts all sanded, it took, you know, a few days actually to hand sand and contour and get all the imperfections and tool marks out of all the different parts of the assembly. After I'd gotten them all polished down with fine sandpaper, I oiled everything with Danish oil and hung all the little parts on this little makeshift tree, drying tree that I made up out of some scraps and some wire that I could hang all the parts on so that they wouldn't be sitting on a surface. And with Danish oil, it's got you know, varnish in it. It's sort of like an oil varnish mixture. So it penetrates into the wood and then solidifies in the wood. So it makes the surface of the wood harder and more chip resistant. So I let that sit overnight to fully harden. And the next day did the final assembly, snapped those last final pins in, and it was done. The only thing I had to do, the only last step that I had to do, was to make the brass inserts for the bolt holes on the base. Chop them out, file them down, finish them, and these brass inserts were all interference fit. Again, the holes were made, you know, just to the exact tolerance, and I just pushed them in very finely with a block, and you know, they're sitting there all nestled. The brass inserts will help in taking the load of the bolts and also you know, prevent any chipping. Yeah, the arc of using wood and brass, walnut and brass, people have commented that it's a very Jules Verne kind of a thing, and that's really what I was shooting for. I'm learning the piano for the first time. I'm actually taking like music lessons after 38 years of being a musician. I'm actually taking music lessons. I'm learning classical piano and I've learned a lot about the mechanics of pianos, and I was really struck by how fine and delicate a lot of the wooden parts and piano mechanisms are and how much punishment they take. And it was really that, thinking of the inner workings of pianos, that really made me want to make this out of wood. And also the overarching theme of going from the earliest aircraft made of wood, brass, and steel to Apollo, that arc of aviation. I really wanted to, you know, to put a tribute to that. And the arc, too, of a single human lifetime from the Wright brothers to Apollo 11, you know, a single human lifetime. People who were born in the 19th century, who read in the newspapers that human beings had flown at Kitty Hawk, were still alive to watch the moon landing on television. And that is the miracle of the technology and the will that took us to the moon. And I wanted to pay a homage to all that in doing this the hard way, and also because I incorporated the most modern technology along with the most tried and true historic woodworking techniques to make this latch replica. It became a transcendent experience for me to create this, a labor of love, an object of love, my passion for space, my passion for making things, my love of wood, and just, yeah, my blood, sweat, tears, my heart is in this piece. And so it's an honor for me to be able to include this in the Adam Savage Project, have it assembled at the Smithsonian and have it archived there. I lose the words to describe the feelings of, I'm humbled and honored to have been able to do this. And the end result is that it's just, I'm so proud of this. I seldom import the word pride into a sentence in relation to things I do, but I'm very proud of this latch. It was a formative experience for me. I definitely want to thank everyone on Team Savage for inviting me into the whole thing, and look forward to seeing this being put in place with all the other parts made by all the other maker teams from all over the world that were contributing to this project. So, and thanks to all the patrons who made this possible. You stuck in there with me 3 weeks to do this, and so thank you everyone on Patreon for making all these videos possible, for making this adventure of FranLab possible. Thank you. I'm Fran. I'll see you around the lab. I got another video I'm going to do this weekend, so stay tuned for that, and we'll just keep moving on this adventure, FranLab 2.0, Philly style. Bye! Savage.